What's going on, guys? My name is Dustin, and this is End on a Make. And just wanted to hop on really quick because there was, I guess, you know, some big news today coming out of the NBA buyout market in particular. And that is that LaMarcus Aldridge has decided to join the Brooklyn Nets. Now, this isn't so much a surprise because a lot of people kind of tipped off that he was considering them and kind of leaning towards them when it was first announced that he was going to be bought out by the Spurs, or, well, I should say that they agreed to part ways. But, you know, now it's finally here, so I thought it'd be important to hop on and kind of talk a little bit about what I think that's going to mean for really just the Nets. But I wanted to take a second before I dive into all that and talk about the Spurs, because growing up as a Lakers fan, I know I have the ball in the background and everything, like, I hated the Spurs. I hated everything about them. I hated Tim Duncan. I hated Manu Ginobili. I hated Tony Parker. I hated Greg Popovich. I hated Robert Horry when he went there. I hated Bruce Bowen. Like, I took it so hard when the Lakers would play the Spurs and lose. It would just make me so upset. And so growing up, I had this mentality of, like, the Spurs are the worst. There were a couple other teams too, but it was always the Spurs. I always had problems with the Spurs. And as I've gotten older, I started watching more teams, started, you know, liking the game more than just liking the Lakers. And the Spurs continue to be one of, you know, the pinnacle organizations in the league. Now, they're not as good this season as, you know, years past, but they are still a competitive in the mix for the play-in tournament or back half of the West, you know, seeding. Like, they're still a competitive, fun team to watch. They have a ton of young, exciting players to watch. DeMar DeRozan's completely changed his game around this late in the game with his evolution as a playmaker and a passer. And I think, you know, to me it speaks volumes that the Spurs would be the organization involved in all this. So when LaMarcus first got there, he had that year that was, you know, not what anyone expected. He did not fit in like they wanted and like anyone predicted. They struggled. They came in under expectations. And afterwards, it kind of came out quickly that he wanted out. And Popovich admitted, you know, I handled things wrong. I should have been better. I used him wrong and tried to make him do things that he's not accustomed to doing and that aren't his game. And that's a huge, huge step from a coach to admit that type of fault. So from there to here now, 6 years, after 6 years with the team, I should say, they're letting him go, they're buying him out, and Popovich put out a statement today that was basically saying, you know, LaMarcus was the true professional, can't wait to see what he does in Brooklyn, he's going to be great, we know he can contribute, and it was a cool touch to see. It was cool to see the Spurs, because, you know, so often with these buyout, it feels like such a disingenuous type of thing. It's like, yeah, we bought him out, we paid him to leave, and now he's gonna go ring chase. But, you know, it felt like a genuine thing from them, and that was, you know, maybe not an important thing to many people, but as someone who grew up like despising the Spurs, it's just, you know, it's another reminder about how well that organization really is run from top to bottom. So now enough about that. I spoke about that a little longer than I thought I would, but LaMarcus to the Nets, I don't really know how I feel about it, to be honest. I mean, the rich get richer with Brooklyn, sure. They're going to roll out, I think it was like a total of 41 combined all-star appearances now between their five stars. So it's Kyrie, James Harden, Kevin Durant, Blake Griffin, LaMarcus Aldridge. You would assume that lineup will see the floor sometimes, but I kind of hope it doesn't, and this is why I'm so hesitant to really be like, wow, the Nets really reloaded, and LaMarcus Aldridge is going to push them over the top, is because the Nets have gotten really good play out of their other guys. In particular, Bruce Brown, who has been, you know, not like career scoring year, but just in terms of what he does, the intangibles he brings to the court, he has been absolutely a breakout this season for them when he's been given the opportunities to get out there. So it's kind of tough to be taking minutes away from him. Then you have Nick Claxton, who's finally healthy, and he's playing big. And he brings the Nets the thing that I think that they miss the most, and that these signings with Blake Griffin and LaMarcus Aldridge don't really address, which is that big defensive energy. He is, you know, he's a center who plays big, will go in and battle for boards, and, you know, he's not the most polished defender, but his effort and his drive is that of a young, hungry player. And you see that when he's on the court. And yes, he gets his offensive opportunities, but that's probably a large benefit of playing with, you know, skilled guys like Harden and Kyrie, skilled playmakers like that. And then not even to say when Kevin Durant gets back, the type of open court he's going to be seeing. But I hope that this isn't a situation where they're like, okay, well, now we have to play Blake and LaMarcus, or Blake and DeAndre, or LaMarcus and DeAndre. And it kind of just pushes those guys out. The real player that I wanted to focus on that I hope doesn't see a diminished role with this signing. And, you know, Steve Nash has been pretty smart about his rotations, and it's not really an issue now while KD is hurt. But Joe Harris needs to continue seeing the court as often as he does. He, I want to say, is just under 30 minutes a game right now. And he is shooting 49% from three, 51% from the field, and hitting just over three threes a game. The open looks that that man can get with everyone else on the court when that offense is humming, and it's more than that. He moves off the ball really well. He cuts. He always seems to be able to get one or two layups where he just catches a defender sleeping and just cuts to the rim. And that's the type of stuff that makes the stacked talent, the all-star players, you know, so deadly, is they're able to just hit him, they're able to feed him, and it just kind of keeps everything moving, keeps the ball popping, and opens everything up. So I'm a little concerned that by going and getting him, they're going to be at a position where they feel they have to play everybody, and it's not going to just be like LaMarcus just came to get a free ride and grab himself a ring. Also, too, defensively, this team still has some questions to answer. Now, LaMarcus is averaging career lows basically across the board in points, rebounds, assists. But this season, it's tough to say that because he's only played in like 21 games. He had an injury earlier on. Then they decided they were going to part ways, and he stopped playing like 2 weeks ago. So it's a little tough to say that. Take that with a grain of salt. But where he's looked really bad, what really got him out of the rotation in San Antonio was his defense. He was getting, you know, outplayed by Jakob Poeltl and a few other Spurs big guys that they were like, you know, we'll just keep running with what we have. And he just kind of found himself on the outs. And now going to Brooklyn already has a bottom third defense currently. Now, they score with anyone, of course, and they're probably banking on just outscoring everyone, and the defense will get better when Kevin Durant comes back because he is that good, but it's a lot to ask. It's a lot to ask, hey, we're going to bring in a couple older players, a couple veterans, we're going to get them their shots, you know, at least a few shots a game, and we need them to just put out all kinds of effort, and this might be a whole lot of nothing. This might be a whole lot about nothing, because as we saw the other night, Blake had 17 against the Pistons, looked absolutely great, and that was with just James Harden. It wasn't with Kyrie. It wasn't with KD. And, you know, he benefited from the open looks. He was aggressive. So there's a really good chance that LaMarcus, you know, simply it wasn't a good fit in San Antonio. He wasn't really putting his all into it. And we could see a similar type of, you know, okay, now he's putting in the effort. I just think that to crown them is a little premature. But that said, it's funny because as soon as this news broke, I noticed that on Twitter, Lakers in six was trending anyways. I don't think I'd go that far quite yet. I really want to see what this whole team looks like together with everyone healthy. Now, who knows when we'll get to see KD with everybody, but they already said Kyrie would be back after three games. I think that's Monday's the last game he'll be out, but I cannot wait to see all of these pieces together and playing off of one another. And as for you know, all of the wide range of opinions, I'm really happy for Nets fans. That's a fan base that loves their Nets. That's a team that has, you know, not been completely in the dark, but that's a team that has seen some dark days, especially following that big trade with Boston for Pierce and Garnett. So to see them get to this, like, I'm not going to hate on it. I'm not going to hate on them adding another all-star player. I'm not going to hate on them, you know, going all in for that championship, because I've watched the Lakers do it plenty of times with varying results, and I've enjoyed watching it pretty much every time. So I can't sit here and be like, Nets fans should be like disappointed or anything like that. I'm curious to see how it looks from a basketball fit, because I don't want to see these types of signings eat into the chemistry that those role players have and that those young players have together. But at the same time, this could also just be a, hey, we're going to go get LaMarcus so no one else can get LaMarcus. I really don't know. I mean, it remains to be seen how much he has to offer. The last thing I will say before I get out of here is I think it's the only thing I think is kind of funny, and I don't mean to make a KD joke here, but I remember reading that one of the reasons he left the Warriors was because he was tired of people saying that, like, he coasted to a title. He coasted to his two titles with Steph and Klay and Draymond and those Warriors teams. And I think it's funny that the narrative that I kept reading when he went to Brooklyn was he wanted to do it on his, like, he wanted to build his own thing. And now here we are, him and Kyrie, they trade for James Harden. They signed LaMarcus Aldridge and Blake Griffin off of the buyout market. Who knows what else there could be that they're going to add in the next couple weeks as they shore up for the playoff run. But obviously, I'm going to be really interested to see what fans and analysts have to say. Not so much analysts. I'm going to be curious to see what fans have to say if the Nets do happen to make this run and go all the way and win the title with James Harden playing at an MVP level. And, like, if he keeps this going, carries them through the playoffs, and they win a title, and he gets Finals MVP or something, I'm just saying I'll be a little curious to see. But that's it. That's all I got. If you have thoughts on what you think LaMarcus will bring to the Nets, please drop them in the comments. I would love to hear them. If you watch the entire thing, I appreciate it very much. And that's it. I appreciate it. Thank you, guys. I will be back soon.